Well, we're in a fairly short series, about three or four talks in. We've titled it The Way, and it's about rediscovering some of the lost practices of the Christian church. Rediscovering some lost practices of the Christian church. We finished recently a series on Ephesians, and I could live there for the rest of my life. Ephesians warmed my heart. It inspired me to worship more. I found my love for the Lord getting deepened. As I've listened in this series to Julie and Jordan, I find my life has changed. And that's what I hope happens for all of us. A line from Jordan's talk last week that stayed with me all week is this line. Let's give Jesus the first word in the day and the last word in the day. Do you remember that? Give him the first word in the day and the last word in the day. Now, my problem hasn't always been the first word in the day, but it's the last word in the day. I usually end up watching the news or something like that, and I found that this last week, I've readjusted my life so that Jesus gets not only the first word, but the last word, and that's what we hope this series does, is it just changes us in terms of our thinking, our behavior, our way of life. In other words, that this series becomes transformative for us. Next week, I'm going to talk to you about a tough topic, but an important one, called a simple lifestyle. That's a forgotten practice of the Christian church, a simple lifestyle. We need to think that through carefully. And I'm going to take you to Matthew chapter 6, especially the last part. I'd love it if you read it, and it kind of primed the pump for next week. Then the following 2 weeks, I want to talk to you about the grace of giving, the grace of giving. And I'm going to take you to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 1 week, then 2 Corinthians chapter 9 the next week, and we'll look at that. But these are forgotten practices of the Christian church. The practice I want to talk to you about today is found in an Old Testament book called Judges. Judges. And it's in chapter 2. And I'm going to read a few verses, and one of them is the most tragic verse that I think you'll find in the whole Bible. One of the most tragic verses you could find in the whole Bible. Judges chapter 2, I want to start at verse 6. It says, after Joshua had dismissed the Israelites, they went to take possession of the land, each to their own inheritance. The people served the Lord throughout the lifetime of Joshua and of the elders who outlived him, and who had seen all the great things the Lord had done for Israel. Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110. They buried him in the land of his inheritance. And then the most tragic verse in the Bible, in my mind. After that, whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors. Another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Just let that hit you again. After that whole generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation grew up who neither knew the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals. They forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of Egypt. They followed and worshiped various gods of the peoples around them. They provoked the Lord to anger because they forsook him and served Baal, the Ashtoreths. Tragic, tragic stuff. A whole generation had witnessed God do amazing things. He opened a river. They walked through on dry ground, and they conquered Jericho and Ai and the land. Now they were living in the land that God had promised them and now given them. These people, they knew the Lord. They loved the Lord, but the next generation, they knew nothing about the Lord. How could that happen? How could it happen that one generation loved the Lord and the next generation neither knows the Lord or any of the great things he does for them? How could that happen? Why I want to talk to you about it today is because I think we're right there. I really do. I think many of us have known the Lord, walked with the Lord. We've seen God do great things. But the generation's coming up. Not even talking out there. I'm talking about our own generation. They hardly know the Lord or what he's done. So the practice that we need to rediscover is the practice of handing our faith on from generation to generation to generation. That's what we need to figure out. How do we hand this faith on so that my kids and my grandkids and their kids, they not only know the Lord and all these, but they love him and they pass the faith on. That's what I want to talk to you about a bit today. You know, I really like to, when I'm reading part of the Bible, I want to know where I'm reading. In God's story, this is the part where God has brought the people out of Egypt and split the sea, and then he carried them for 40 years in the wilderness. Now, under Joshua, they conquered the land, and they're actually in the land that God had promised them. They're there. And this is where this all takes place. Judges is a tough book. I don't like it. I don't like reading it. I try to read the Bible through every year, and when I come to Judges, it just slows down. It's depressing. It's discouraging. It's dark. It's violent. And it's full of tragic figures. There's no king. A summary of the book is really the last statement in the whole book. In those days, Israel had no king, and everybody did what was right in their own eyes. That's the summary statement for that period of time. So what God did is from time to time, he raised up judges, rulers, leaders that would rescue the people from their enemies. But the problem with the judges is they were flawed and they were failing and they were half the time as bad or worse than the people. It's a terrible story. It led Tim Keller to throw out this line about the book of Judges once. He said, it's trashy tales about dysfunctional characters. I don't know if I'd put it that way, but I can see where he gets that from. Yes, there's nothing, in some ways, I always used to think there's nothing redemptive in the book, but this week, as I got into it, here's what I learned about Judges. It's a book about the grace of God. It's actually a book about the grace of God. God relentlessly, not recklessly, God relentlessly offers his grace to people who don't deserve it, seek it, or even appreciate it. God relentlessly offers his grace to people who don't deserve it, who don't seek it, who don't appreciate it. And I find that incredibly encouraging, don't you? Because there's so many times when I don't deserve it. I don't seek it. I don't appreciate it. And yet that relentless grace of God is there, chasing us down. It's a book about grace abounding to the chief of sinners. That's what it is. It's also a book about, and you can read the book at your leisure, it's a book about our need for a Savior. Our need for a Savior. Because the book shows that nothing ultimately can rescue us from pride, selfishness, and rebellion. That's at the heart of all the folly in this book, and it's the heart of all the folly in my life. Pride, selfishness, rebellion, and nothing can rescue us from that, and we need a Savior. And God raises up these judges, and the people think they're going to be a Savior, but then they save them, sort of, and they fall right back into their stuff. One of the judges, the first one you really run into is Othniel, and he gathers the whole country together and gives a great victory to the country. God saves through Othniel, through all. Then you have Deborah. We learn that God can save through many. Then you'll bump into Gideon, and you'll realize that God can save with few. And then you get Samson, and you realize that God can save through one. And you realize at that point that the book begins to point ahead to the rest of God's revelation, to the one that will come and be the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, King of kings and Lord of lords. The book points to our need of a Savior and ultimately points to Christ. I need the book of Judges, even though I don't like it. Three millennia plus ago it all occurred. And yet there's so many parallels to the world I live in and you live in. They lived in a society shot through with religious pluralism. There were pagans and believers. There were people worshiping this God and that God. It was religious pluralism. And And the world I live in and you live in, it's not much different. Every day back in Judges, they had to decide, is Jesus going to be Lord and Master? God going to be Lord and Master? Or am I going to give in to the preferences and the lifestyles around me? And in my world, there's many gods too. Consumerism, self, pleasure, sport, money, sex, name it. And every day I have to make choices whether I'm going to say Jesus is Lord or I'm going to pursue one of these things. It's not a lot different. This is a really important book for us to get our heads around. And this book says, Israel had no king. Everybody did what was right in their own eyes. Is that not what's happening in the world today? There's no God for most people. Everybody just does what's right in their own eyes. And it's no wonder that a generation was lost and that we're on the brink of that too. So I thought what I'd do, I'm no expert on this stuff. I have more times I've blown it than done well, but I've thought about it. And I want to make a few suggestions to you about how we might pass on the faith to the next generations. I want to talk about that with you. Now, just an interesting, sad insight into this verse. After that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord or what he'd done. Knew there, the word knew probably doesn't mean they hadn't heard about the Exodus. Probably doesn't mean that they hadn't heard some of the stories, but what it means is it wasn't precious to them, it wasn't central to them, and they ignored it. And so they had no relationship with this God that they had heard about. No covenant relationship with this God. The things of God weren't precious to them, not central to them. They forgot those things, cast them aside. And when that happens, you turn to evil. And so the next verse says, then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals. What is turning to evil according to this book? It's turning to false gods, idols. Baal isn't really a proper name, even though it's put that way in our text. Baal was just a common Canaanite name for master, for Lord. And what it's saying here is that evil is forsaking the Lord for many lords. Evil is forsaking the true God for many gods. That's evil. Turning to idols. Broken cisterns, Jeremiah says, they can't hold water. Jeremiah puts it vividly. He says, you've forsaken the spring of living water, and you're drinking from broken cisterns that can't even hold water. What are you doing? They turn from God to many God, from Lord to many lords, and that's evil in God's eyes. And when you find yourself with the things of God not precious, not central in your life, you do evil in the eyes of the Lord, and it's a slippery slope down from there. I just jotted some notes to myself quickly this week about this. Tell you the truth, it kicked around in my brain more than me sitting down and studying it out properly, but I couldn't get away from it. Here's some things I thought about. If we're going to pass the faith on to the next generations, we need to have a generational vision because God does. We need to have a generational vision because God does. We need to think beyond ourselves and see the generations coming and have that kind of a vision because God does. What do I mean when I say God does? This is what I found this week, very interesting. Think three, because God does. God usually thinks three generations out. Exodus 3:15, how does he describe himself? The God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, three generations. You'd be amazed. I could take you on a Bible study the whole morning on all the references where God thinks three generations out. I'll just give you a few. There's Psalms, Psalm 102. I'm sorry about my voice today. I have no idea what's going on, but that's my fault. Hang in there. Summer's coming. You'll hear some better speakers. But Psalm 102, verse 28. The children of your servants will live in your presence. Their descendants will be established before you. That's three generations. You, your children, and your descendants will be established before you. God thinks three generations out. Psalm 103, verse 17. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children. Three generations. Right? This just rolls through Scripture. Isaiah 44. I'm just going to read you these few verses. They're great. But now listen, Jacob, my servant, Israel, whom I've chosen. This is what the Lord says. He made you, he formed you in the womb, and he will help you. Do not be afraid, Jacob, my servant. And then he uses a nickname, Jeshurun, whom I've chosen. For I'll pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. Here it is. I'll pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. You, your offspring, and your descendants. Three generations. God has a generational vision. Joel, of all places. I'm reading Joel. Then I come across it. Listen to Joel chapter 1 and verse 3. Tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and so on. Three generations. You know, we need a generational vision as a church and as families and as individuals, a generational vision, because God does. He's always looking beyond where we're at now. And any vision that stops here is not a God-sized vision. Generational vision. I wondered what that might look like. What does a generational vision actually look like practically? Well, it means you have to get God's heart for the next generation, the one after that. You have to have his heart. You have to let him press his heart for these people on you. And it has to break your heart like it breaks his heart. Sometimes we sit there and think these guys are going to hell in a handbasket and they deserve it, and they're identifying as he, she, they, them, Cats, Oilers fans, whatever. And, you know, we're appalled. You knew I had to get it in there somewhere. But God's not appalled. He loves these generations. He loves these kids at Lindsay Thurber, Notre Dame, and over at the Polytech. He loves them. Jesus shed his blood for them. He has a vision for them. He has a heart for them. And we have to get that heart. Christians, we like to withdraw, but, you know, God's people, they always move towards society with love and compassion. That's what they do. That's where you start. You get on your knees and you say, God, please break my heart with the things that break your heart. Amen. And we weep. And we pour out our hearts for them. And we make sacrifices so we can spend time in God's presence asking him to move. Like, this just doesn't happen automatic. It's when God's people get his heart that things begin to change. And then secondly, to have a generational vision is to invest in the coming generations. You invest in them. Invest in them. How so? One thing you can do is just take every opportunity to be involved in their lives. Just involved in your kids' lives, involved in your friends' kids' lives, involved in your grandkids' lives. Just God, open some doors, show me some ways I can just get involved and just be there. Amen. Don't make your bucket list to run away somewhere for half a year. Make your bucket list to be available to your kids and your grandkids. We were in Victoria, and we were hanging out for a week with Rick and Jen and Bennett and Abby. Bennett's in grade 2, and Abby's kind of in play school. Rick gets up one morning and says, Dad, I got a couple appointments, and Jen's busy. Could you drop Bennett off at school? Yep, no problem. I can do that. It's right on the way to the coffee shop. And they said, oh, yeah, by the way, Dad, it's parent reading day. And I said, oh, excuse me? He said, it's parent reading day. And I said, what? What's parent reading day? He said, well, drop them off and just hang out there with all the other parents. And he said, after about 10 minutes when they take attendance, they'll come and get you, and you go in and just read for an hour, 2 hours to Bennett. And I said, oh, really? I was kind of planning to go to Maddox Farms for coffee. He said, Dad, you can do this. And then I thought, opportunity. So I did. Went to the school, Bennett and me got out of the car. He runs into the classroom, and I'm left standing with all these parents younger than my kids. I felt like some kind of predator standing there, and they just, nobody knew me. And so I thought I'd engage in conversation. I said to the lady beside me, hey, how are you? I'm here to do reading. Oh, that's nice, she said, and she turned away. So I turned to these two ladies, and they're right in the middle of a conversation on breastfeeding. I said, awkward, I'm out of, and I stood there, and I thought, this is crazy. And then Bennett comes out, Granddad, come on in. And I thought, well, at least they know who I am. And I went in with all the parents. Parents and kids everywhere reading books. You go to the library, and Bennett pulls three books out. Who would win, a killer whale or a great white shark? Who would win, an alligator or whatever? And it's not. And I said, Bennett, we're going to read these things. Oh, out in the hall, he says. Well, I said, there's no chairs. No, we're going to read in the hall. So we go out in the hall, and he says, we're going to sit right here in the hallway. And I thought, if I get down there, I'll never get up again. But I got down and got up a little later. After an hour, hour and a half, the PA came on, and parents are allowed to go home. And I thought, thank you, Jesus. But here's the thing. Bennett talked about it for the rest of the day. Couldn't get over that I'd go and just read a book to them. Like, somehow we got to figure out how to engage with our kids. Let's take every opportunity. How else do we invest? Well, we make our homes the place of the presence of God. Our homes are the place where memory is stirred up because we remember together the stories of God. I don't know if you noticed in verse 7, the editor is very careful when he puts judges together. And his big point is a generation grows up that neither knows the Lord or what he'd done. And to make the point in verse 7, he uses the word great. They didn't remember the great things God had done. By saying great things God has done, he's highlighting the folly of forgetting God. Where were they supposed to hear about these great things? Well, in their homes. The reason they didn't remember is the generation that should have passed it on came to the end of memory, and it became all about them, and they didn't pass on the stories. They didn't pass on the word. They didn't talk about how God interacted with them. And their kids went to hell. Nobody really cared. All because the parents didn't make the home the place of the presence of God. Place where God's word was honored. Place where it was explained. Place where on Saturday night before communion, they explain what communion stood for and the great act that that symbolized so that when the families came, took it, kids knew what they were doing. They remembered the great acts of God. There's a man in the Bible named Obed-Edom. Strange, obscure man, but well worth remembering. It's an old story, and it's about King David when he's established as king and moves into Jerusalem, and the Ark of God, which symbolized the presence of God, hadn't been there, and David wants to bring it to Jerusalem. And because of the chaos in the land, they'd parked it for 20 years in the home of a man named Abinadab. And the Ark was there, God's presence in Abinadab's home. When they went to move it from Abinadab's home to Jerusalem, one of Abinadab's sons, Uzzah, don't ask me who named him, Uzzah, was going with the procession. And at one point, the ark stumbled, and Uzzah reached out his hand and touched the ark, and God struck him dead. You ever struggled with God, stuff like that? Well, I guess the regulations were clear that Levites carried the ark and touched it, nobody else could. So Uzzah, yeah, he did what he shouldn't, but it seems rather severe, doesn't it? Here's what happened. For 20 years, the place of the presence had been in Uzzah's home, Benadab's home. But God wasn't honored there. And what was holy became common. When something holy becomes common, and you lose the fear of God, how do you restore that fear? Only by a dramatic act like what happened to Uzzah. And in one incident, the fear of God was restored. I sometimes fear when we come to communion that some of us might have allowed the holy to become common. And how is that restored? Well, that was happened to Uzzah. So David, he was scared to death now. He didn't want anything to do with the ark. And so he said, look, we're right by Obed-Edom's house. Let's put it in there. There it goes. Obed-Edom's house. And then in Chronicles, it says this amazing thing. You guys should read Chronicles. It's really good. If you have an old Bible, it's where the pages still stick together. But it says that God blessed Obed-Edom and his family and his whole house because of the presence. In other words, Obed-Edom honored the presence of God in his home, made a place for God, and God blessed him. That might be enough. But if you pursue Chronicles, you'll come to these lists at the end of the book, which is like, oh my goodness, this guy begat, this guy begat, this guy. And I say, why did God put this in the Bible? I can't even pronounce the names, let alone get anything out of it. But I'm traveling through there the other day, and here's what I came across in 1 Chronicles 26. Just listen to this. The divisions of the gatekeepers, and then all these guys long since dead. And apparently Obed-Edom was a gatekeeper. Because it said Obed-Edom's sons, they followed him as gatekeepers. And it names them Shemaiah, Jehozabad, Joah, Zachar. I need Denise for the rest of them, whole pile of them. And then this bracket where God had blessed Obed-Edom. He had all these sons that followed him in the work of the Lord. Because God blessed Obed-Edom, because Obed-Edom made a place for God in his home. And then, Obed-Edom's son Shemaiah also had sons who were leaders in their father's family. And it lists all of these guys. And they're men of God. Descendants of Obed-Edom, 62 in all. Three generations. Obed-Edom honored God. His sons did. And his grandkids did, and they all followed him in the way of the Lord. How do you invest in the next generation? You know, none of our homes are perfect. We're all dysfunctional. It's just a matter of degree. But wherever we find ourselves, we make a commitment to make our home the place of the presence. God will be honored here. We'll read the word here. We'll tell the stories here. We'll pray here. This will be a place where we honor God. And God honors those that honor him. You invest in the next generation also by giving to the work of the Lord. With young people, children's ministry, youth ministry. This is why I talked to you earlier about giving. This is huge stuff, you guys. We want to have a generational vision where the generations grow up to know and love the God that's been so powerfully at work in our church and in our lives and our community. A generational vision. You think three and you invest in it. Let me give you a couple quick pointers. If I had a second point, it would be this. Well, I guess I do. Don't think small because God doesn't.
Amen.
Don't think small because God doesn't. Pray big. Ask big. Don't just pray your kids to come to know the Lord. Pray that they would come to know the Lord and love him and live for him with all their hearts and actually fulfill the purpose that God created them for. Yep. Go for broke. Read the scriptures. Here's one. Jeremiah chapter 1. God says to Jeremiah, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. What the word knew means? Chose you, set you apart, had purpose for you, even before you got to the womb. Crazy. And then I read about Isaiah 49, it says there, I can't quote it offhand. Some things, you know, when you get to this advanced age, things pop in and out of your head. It's quite interesting, actually. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my mother's womb, he's spoken my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened arrow. Before I was born, he called me. Like, you say, well, that's Jeremiah, that's Isaiah. No, it's all of us, because I read this morning Psalm 40. And Psalm 40, it'll blow you away. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you've done, the things you planned for us. Nobody could count. God, when your kids and your grandkids were in the womb, God had dreams and visions and plans for them. Some of them to be doctors and lawyers and teachers and plumbers and school teachers and pastors and people that would impact the society and be salt and light, pray that God's purpose in their life would be fulfilled. Here's some way you can pray. You could pray that God would show you what he was speaking over your kids in the womb. Try that. I did once, and God showed me. Pray that God would show you what was in his heart when he was forming your grandkids in the womb. And then pray in that way. Encourage that way. Pray big. Don't worry about the world. God's bigger than that. The Holy Spirit's greater than that. So you want to, you know, you're afraid when they go to school. Let the Bible instruct you how to pray. I pray this way from Genesis chapter 1. I try and make the Bible my prayer book. Genesis 1, it says, there was chaos and darkness before the work of creation started, and the Spirit of God hovered over the darkness. You know what the word hovered there means? Boundaried it in. Wouldn't let the chaos get past. I've prayed that for my kids and grandkids. Lord, hover over them, boundary them in. Set boundaries around them that it's impossible for them to break through. Great way to pray. Pray big. Pray for this city. Pray for our high schools. Like, I believe that God could pour out his Spirit on our high schools and turn the hearts of a whole generation to himself. Can you imagine this place was packed with kids that just want to worship? And pray for the Polytech, you know, that God's Spirit comes in power there. Like, why would we not remember that God thinks big and pray that way? Here's a God that can do more than you could ask or ever imagine. I can imagine God's Spirit sweeping through the high schools. God says, I can do more than that. I know more than that. Think about this. He says to Abraham, Abraham, come out of here for me. Abraham, come out of here. Get out of the tent. Get away from the TV. Get out of here. And he says, look up at the stars. Count them. I'll give you more descendants than that. You know that lake you were at last week? See if you can count the sand. Yeah. I'll make your descendants more than that. This is a God that's not a small thinker. Ask big. Ask God to do the impossible. God wants to save whole families. He's not content with 1, 2, 3. Ask for the whole thing. Jesus is the one that said, ask and you receive, seek and you find, knock and the door will be open unto you. And I got to close this door because I'm going to be in trouble. So I got to find out where I am. Here's one last thing. If we're going to see a generation love the Lord, we ourselves must love God wholeheartedly. You'd think it hardly needs to be said, but I saw it in Deuteronomy chapter 6. Let's look at that. Deuteronomy chapter 6 says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Three persons who are one God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands. Maybe that's a tattoo, I don't know. And bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. This is powerful stuff. God says, listen, you want a generation that follows me, then you follow me. Give me your whole heart. This is a defining moment in the life of CrossRoads. I really believe that God wants to turn our hearts back to himself because he's intent on rescuing a generation. It's got to start in the house here. I'll end with this. You know, my grandfather was one of the big spiritual influences in my life. Huge, actually. As a young man, he was a coal miner. And in his 20s, he heard the gospel and gave his heart to Christ. And I tell you what, he wasn't the kind of grandfather that would throw a ball or, you know, I don't think I ever saw him without a tie on, really. But there was something about him that was just so compelling. Love to go visit them. He'd always throw me a book and say, you should read that. Maybe that's where I got my love of reading. I don't know. You know, it was through my grandfather that I first learned that God speaks personally to you. I knew God's book was there, and it was kind of his word generally, but I had no idea that he wants to speak to you personally from this book. But when I was going to Briarcrest, I was leaving Vancouver at 18 to go to Briarcrest, which was the ends of the earth from Vancouver. Never been on the prairies, didn't know what they were. And he hand wrote a verse out and he gave it to me. It was Genesis 28:15, where God says, I'm with you. And I'll watch over you wherever you go. And I'll bring you back again to this land. And I won't leave you until I've done all that I promised you. Like it was, man, it was powerful on my heart. And I thought, cool, I get to come back to Vancouver. That's what it said. And that's what happened. But as I've grown older, I've realized that when God speaks once, he always speaks that to you. That's the most powerful verse in my life. And I remember the day God showed me that land is an Old Testament theme, but not a New Testament one. That the inheritance of land becomes Christ in the New Testament. We don't inherit real estate. We inherit Christ. And when that verse said, I'll bring you back again to this land, I've seen it in a new light. I'll bring you back again to Christ. I've wandered. I've taken detours. But God has always brought me back because he said he would. And he does. And he made promises to me. And I hold on to them. Haven't seen them all fulfilled yet, but he said, I won't leave you until I've done all that I promised you. My grandfather was the first man that told me, showed me that God speaks personally, and it's become my life verse. He led his four boys to the Lord, one of whom was my dad. My dad led us to the Lord. We led our kids to the Lord. They're leading their kids to Jesus. At the end of the 1800s, my grandfather's decision to live for Christ has impacted five generations. Your decision today to live for Christ will have a ripple effect through the generations that you won't be able to get your head around until you get to eternity. This is urgent stuff, and none of us are off the hook. None of us. You see, my family's gone. I'm a single parent, or I'm single. Doesn't matter. You can pray. Doesn't matter. You can invest. You can serve in our children's ministry. That's not a volunteer thing. That's a service thing. You can invest in our youth. Nobody's off the hook. The question I leave you with today would be this question. Where are you investing in the next generations? So that it won't be said of us that after we all died and went to heaven, a generation grew up in Red Deer that neither knew the Lord or the great things he's done. Let's stand together, pray. Father, your word is always powerful to our hearts, and on Sunday, sometimes by Monday we forget it. I pray you wouldn't let us off the hook, but you would take the things that the Holy Spirit's talking to us about. You'd embed them on our hearts and give us the grace to live into them, for we pray in Jesus' name, amen.